I'd like to welcome everyone to the New Life Fellowship evening service. I'm ready to get the praise on. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's, got a pastor appreciation dinner coming on the 16th of this month. Let's not forget Kathy's class on Friday night, every Friday night at 6:30. And there's some little flyers that's been floating around about those items and the things that we need in the pantry. If you have any other questions, you'll have to see our illustrious pantry take care of her person.
Put you on the spot or anything.
Praise the Lord. All right, let's go to our Abba Father. Abba Father, once again, we want to thank you and praise you for this day. Thank you so much that we have a place to come to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, I thank you for the word that you place in Sister Cat's heart for us this evening. I pray that whatever it is, Lord God, that we have ears to hear, eyes to see, hearts to receive what you have for us through her. I know she has asked, but I do believe that she wants to decrease while you, Lord God, will increase in her. I do bind up the works of an enemy. I render them useless and powerless. And Father God, you said that when we come against our enemy, we resist our enemy. They may come in one way, but they will flee seven different ways from us, Father God. And that's the way it should be. And as always, Father God, we give you honor, glory, and certainly all the praise. And we ask all of this in the mighty name of Jesus, whom we love and declare by saying,
Amen.
Amen. All right. Praise and worship team. Once again, I want to thank these lovely ladies for joining us this morning. And the way they have been doing. And,
do that again, Cassie.
Think about it. And our illustrious.
My Cassie says, laughter's good for the soul.
It is.
Right. Yes. Also, let's not forget our illustrious
sound
person back there in the corner. Eric. Guy is doing an awesome job. Awesome job. So I thank God for all of these wonderful members. You know, while our other leaders are out, you know, we step up and take care of things. You know,
Amen.
That's the body. That's what Pastor Roger's been teaching about.
Amen.
Body filling in. Amen. All righty. Well, let's carry on. Get our praise on.
I can't count the times I called your name so broken night. And you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia. Thank you, keep coming around. There ain't no way you'll ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me. Praising your name no matter what comes. Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. So you give me your word, he's good. So you God. He's God, he is
God,
God Almighty. You say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. Why would I assume you'd be somebody that you're not? I saw in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day. What on earth would make me be afraid? Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me. Praise your name no matter He's good. He's good. He's God. He is good God Almighty. Praise him in the morning. Praise him in the noontime. Praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning. Love him in the noontime. Love him when the sun goes down. Good God Almighty. I hope you'll find me. Praise him your day, no matter what color. Cause I know where I'll be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. So he's good, he's good, he's God, he's God, he is good God Almighty. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down.
Amen.
Amen. Our feet are on the rock.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the wind, they try to shake me. I will not be moved, my feet on the rock. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now, my feet on the rock. When I feel my hold about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way, I'll be dancing in the rain. I'll be around the rock. I can see the morning light. I can feel the joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground. Even hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock. As the solid rock, I stand on the ground, it's sinking sand. So it's on your feet and clap your hands. My feet are on the rock. On Christ's solid rock, I stand all on the ground in sinking sand. So stop your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ's solid rock, I stand all on the ground in sinking sand. So stop your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. And I feel my hold about to break. I'm looking to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. And I feel my hope about to break. I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock. My feet are on the rock. My feet are on the rock.
Hey, man. Yeah.
Yeah. Love has the power. Yeah. Love Jesus shed for me, way back on Calvary, the blood
that you've been straying from day to day. You'll never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountains, and it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that is restrained from day to day, you will never lose his power.
Thank you.
It soothes my doubts and calms my fears. And it dries all my tears. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. You reach us to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Yeah. That gives me strength from day to day. You'll never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. When love gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose. It will never lose. It will never lose.
Just kind of imagine when he walked the road carrying that cross, leading all the way. The drops of blood were falling on the ground. Even the ground, it was anointed with his blood for all of us. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you saw fit to put your life on the line for each and every one of us. Yes. Father God, you've called us one by one. You've called us by our name. We've answered. We answered, yes, Lord, we will come. We made the confession. You were born of a virgin. That you died on the cross for our sins. And you rose the third day. That we may have life. And have life more abundant.
Yes.
Thank you for that this evening, Father.
Thank you.
We just thank you so much that your presence is here. I feel you, Lord Jesus. You are here. You wrap your arms around each and every one of us. You love us. You love us so much. I thank you once again for your saving grace, your amazing grace. Kept you on the cross. And you said in a final breath of your life, you said, it is finished. We say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, let's put our hands together and let's welcome Sister Cat. And she's on the microphone, ready to go.
Well, bear with me because I never did a message like this. I thought I was going to be teaching on godly wisdom, but my PowerPoint people aren't here, so God did something totally different.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm going to pray before I start, though. The devil's really come against me with this. I had part of my message on Friday, and I didn't get to finish it until this afternoon after I got out of church. And I worked on it until it was time to come to church. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Father God, I just ask you to help me decrease so that you can increase. Let nothing come out of these lips that are not of you, Father Lord God. Anoint my lips, Father God. I bind every demonic spirit that's coming against me right now in the name of Jesus. I loose your Holy Spirit to go forth and make a way where it seems to be none. And I just praise you and I thank you, Father God, that you are here amongst all of us, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I want to start out with a praise report. And at first when I tell you, it's not going to sound like a praise report because it didn't sound like fun for me at first either, but it hit the mother in me. As everybody knows, my son was going to get sentenced, and I kept it hush-hush because I felt like God was going to use it as a focus point for a message. He went to court. He told me I was supposed to be there on the 19th of September on a Monday. He was going to get sentenced. Well, something told me to call the district clerk's office. And they said, no, that he has court the 16th to announce jury announcement and jury trial on the 28th of September. I said, so he's not getting sentenced on Monday. And they said, no. And I said, well, what if they come up with a plea? Will he get sentenced then? She said, no, ma'am. She goes, they have to put a new motion in for that. So I didn't feel confident in that. So I called the attorney, but they basically told me the same thing. Well, he was supposed to go to court that Friday at 9 o'clock. I didn't go because there was no reason for me to be there. And I don't know, it must have been about 11 o'clock. I started feeling sick. Not sick with illness or disease, but sick like something was terrible wrong. And I knew it concerned him. And God told me to start praying in the spirit. So I did. And then I tried to call Brenda, and her phone went straight to voicemail, which didn't happen. So I sent her a text, told her what the deal was, so I could get back to praying. And I was praying and praying and praying. And a little while later, she called me. She goes, Kat, she goes, my phone is broke. She goes, I don't know what's going on. She goes, I got to take it to AT&T. And I told her, well, just be praying in the spirit. So I started feeling worse and worse. And I told God, I said, I don't know what this is. I said, but you're telling me to pray in the spirit, so I know you're doing something. Yes. About 4 o'clock, he calls me, and I answer the phone, and he goes, let me tell you this part first. He was being charged with 2 counts of aggravated assault on a peace officer with a firearm, which was not true, and some other stuff. And they had on the table 50 years aggravated is what they tried to give him. For 2 years, they wouldn't come off of it, no matter what. His attorney told him He said, you could be running out of a burning church with a brand new baby in your arms, and that DA is not going to budge, is what he told him last time he went to court. And so he called me, and I answered the phone. He goes, well, I'm eligible for parole in 14 months. I said, what? I said, did you get sentenced? And he goes, yeah, 30 years. I said, 30 years? And he goes, yeah, two times. And I said, what are you talking about? You know, that 30-year sentence just went in my heart down to my feet. I'm 67 years old, so 30 years is a lot to me. And he's been in so trouble, I don't know that he'll make parole the first time, you know, 14 months. I doubt that he will. And I told him, he goes, I did this. And when he said that, when I started hearing I's, me, mine, or mine, I started getting quickened in my spirit because that's flesh operating. And so I had to get off the phone because I was going to lose it. Well, it bothered me and bothered me. I was so mad at that boy because I thought he did it in himself. And they can only get text messages till 10 o'clock. And I knew if I didn't text him, I wasn't going to sleep that night. So at 9:45, I texted him and I told him. I said, you know that 30 years, I said, don't sound bad to you, but it does me. I said, I'm really upset because I feel like you jumped the gun and didn't wait on God. And so he called me right away. And he was like a different person when he was talking to me. He goes, Mom, he goes, I know it didn't go the way you thought it would. He says, but really, it's a good deal. I said, how can you say that? And he goes, Mom, he goes, I'm eligible for parole in 14 months. If he would have took the 50-year aggravated, he would have had it done half his time, 25 years before he would have been eligible for parole. And what I didn't know was they also had an evading arrest by motor vehicle on him that carried 25 to life. And he said, Mom, he goes, I prayed all night. He goes, and I prayed again this morning before I went to court. He goes, this is what laid on my heart. Well, I had mailed him this book, Desperate Prayers for Desperate Times. I've read it twice. I'm reading it for the third time because I'm really trying to get this book ingrained in my spirit. And he told me, he was, Mom, he goes, I was reading that book. And he goes, I read the first chapter. He goes, I made a vow to God. And I said, a vow? I chuckled then. I said, huh, you made a vow to God. I said, you better keep it. I said, because it's better not to make a vow to God than make one and then not follow through with it. And he goes, no, Mom. He goes, I did. He goes, I told God. He goes, you get me out of here in a few years. He goes, I promise I'll be in church every Sunday. And I thought, all right. So when he told me about the part about the 25 in life, and he said he was guilty of that, so he would have been convicted at least 25. He would have had to done 12 and a half years before he come up for parole. So all in all, the 30-year thing that struck the mother in me, I was in the flesh, it was the mother, turned out to be a good deal. He's eligible for parole in 14 months. And, I mean, if he don't make it the first time, he'll probably make it the second time. They'll probably set him off for a year. But that's a whole lot better than 25 years.
Amen.
So, yes.
Yes.
God answered prayer. He did a miracle because they threw the vigil at him because he's been in trouble since he's 16, 17 years old. That sentence carried 2 to 10 years, but when they threw that vigil at him, it changed it 3 times, so they gave him the 10 times 3, so that's where the 30 came from. But you know what? It's all good. He's eligible. It's not going to be 25 years. I'll still be alive and kicking, I hope, and still be able to go fishing. That's my fishing buddy that's in there. But anyway, I just wanted to give that praise report, and I'm going to kind of use that as a focus point on what he had to do to get everything changed around. I mean, and it came out of this book. I'm going to teach a little bit on this book, but first, I want to look at some scriptures. You know, when we do things, we sow seeds, no matter if it's good things or bad things. And it's the the sowing and the reaping process is what it is. So, I mean, he's been running from God. He's been a Jonah all this time. It took all this trouble that he got. He's never been in this much trouble before. But it took this for him to get on his knees and look upward. And God gave me that vision of him one day. And I didn't see it. He gave it to me actually the last time he was locked up. But now I've seen it. And he actually, that's what it took for him to get to his knees. And now he's finding favor, so he's got that Joseph anointing on him now.
Yes.
But I'm going to start with Galatians 6, verses 7 through 10. And I'm going to be reading out of the Amplified for this one. Okay.
Galatians
6. Yeah, I know, but I just lost my place. I'm in the wrong verse, that's why. It says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. He will not allow himself to be ridiculed, nor treated with contempt, nor allow his precepts to be scornfully set aside. So whatever a man sows, this and this only is what he will reap. For the one who sows to his flesh, his sinful capacity, his worldliness, his disgraceful impulses, will reap from the flesh ruin and destruction. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not grow weary or become discouraged in doing good. For at the proper time we will reap if we do not give in. So then, while we as individual believers have the opportunity, let us do good to all people, not only being helpful, but also doing that which promotes their spiritual well-being and especially be a blessing to those of the household of faith, born-again believers. You know, I struggled whether I was supposed to give part of this testimony of my son. And I asked my son first if it was okay that if I did that and used his circumstances and his outcome, and he said, yeah. But I still wasn't sure. And then when the pastor was telling jokes this morning, that was the first time I ever heard him use the name Bobby. Well, that was my son. So when I heard Bobby, I thought, okay, Lord, that's my confirmation. That's what I'm supposed to do.
Amen.
Okay, another scripture that I want to read, and I'm going to be reading the rest out of the New King James Version. Move that out of the way. And I'm going to be reading Proverbs 22, verse 8. He who sows iniquity will reap sorrow, and the rod in his anger will fail. The third one is Proverbs 28:20. A faithful man will abound with blessings, but he who hastens to be rich will not go unpunished. And then I'm going to go to Hosea 10:12.
What was that,
Kat? Tags in there, but they're all running together.
Amen.
Sow for yourselves righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. Okay, so he understands that, you know, some of this came from the seeds that he had sowed. He reaped in consequences of his actions. Because if he didn't, I mean, he wouldn't have got that habitual thrown at him. So we discussed that and everything, and, you know, he's trying to get in there with God. He goes to church and everything. And so he had to repent. So we're going to go to 2 Chronicles 30. Verse Who has it? Somebody want to read it for me? 2 Chronicles 30, verse 9.
For if you turn again unto the Lord, your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that lead them into lead them captive, so that they shall come again into this land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you, for ye return unto him.
Amen. Now, I'm setting these scriptures up for what the part I'm going to teach out of this book. The five R's of repentance. One is recognition. You got to recognize the sin and not be in denial about it. The second one is remorse. You got to be genuinely sorry, heartfelt, straight from your heart, that you committed sin. If there's no remorse, there's not going to be forgiveness. Restitution, if possible, pay back. In Bobby's case, he's paying back to society. I mean, he's been a menace. Reformation, the definition of that is the state of being reformed. And five is resolution, a firm decision to do or not to do something, the quality of being determined or resolute. Those are the five R's of repentance. So now he's done that part, so he's asking forgiveness. So we're going to go to 1 John 1:9. Absolutely.
So when the Lord deals with me, until I go to him and repent, I'm miserable. I don't know about anybody else, but I'm miserable. But when I do go and repent, when I come out of that prayer time, I'm a new person. And I'm so happy because I know my relationship's restored to him. And it wasn't it.
Amen. There's a weight lifted off of us. A big weight.
It's not worth it. It's not worth it to hold on to whatever you hold on to, because it puts a wall between you and God and your prayers and answer. And it's not worth it.
It's not worth it. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then we're going to go to Psalm 103, verse 3. Psalm 103 is my favorite psalm in the Bible. It has so many of God's promises in it. And I stand on all of them. Well, let's go up to 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all our iniquities and who heals all of our diseases. And then he had to find mercy. And that's in Psalms 103, 11 and 12. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. And then there's grace. He had to fall under grace. And we're going to go to Ephesians 4:7. There were steps he had to go through. I wish he was out here doing this himself, but there's going to come a time he knew he will. He will be behind the pulpit. It says, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. And James 4, 6 and 7. If you never had me teach you this, and you saw this scripture.
He's backing up Bobby, what he did.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why he got bad was him.
In regard to these, they think it's strange that you do not. Oh, wait a minute. I'm not even going to write 4:7. But the end of all things is at hand, therefore be serious and watchful in your prayers. Oh, wait a minute. I'm in the wrong thing. Oh, my God. Here it is. But he gives more grace, therefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And let's read 8. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. You're double-minded. You know, in the one scripture that sums all this up, if we will take these steps and turn back to God, and it's all said in John 3:16.
Yes.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
Oh, I guess I do that more scripture.
It's good.
When the pastor was teaching on this morning, that he was in James, I discovered this in my Bible this morning. I got blessed with this Bible. It's actually handed down. But I love it. I so love it. And before, it's an introduction to James, because the pastor was talking about faith this morning, too. I mean, we got to have faith. And the title of this message is Have Faith and Trust God. It says, faith without works cannot be called faith. Faith without works is dead. And a dead faith is worse than no faith at all. Faith must work. It must produce. It must be visible. Verbal faith is not enough. Mental faith is insufficient. Faith must be there, but it must be more. It must inspire action. Faith is an action word.
Yes, it is.
Throughout his epistle to Jewish believers, James integrates true faith and everyday practical experience by stressing that true faith must manifest itself in works of faith. Faith endures trials. Trials come and go, but a strong faith will face them head on and develop endurance. Faith understands temptations. It will not allow us to consent to our lust and slide into sin. Faith obeys the word.
Yes.
It will not merely hear it and not do. Faith produces doers. Faith harbors no prejudice. For James, faith and favoritism cannot coexist. Faith displays itself in works. Faith is more than mere words. It is more than knowledge. It is demonstrated by obedience, and it overly responds to the promises of God. Faith controls the tongue. This small but immensely powerful part of the body must be held in check. Faith can do it. Faith acts wisely. It gives us the ability to choose wisdom that is heavenly and to shun wisdom that is earthly. Faith produces separation from the world and submission to God.
Yes.
It provides us with the ability to resist the devil and humbly draw near to God. Finally, faith waits patiently, there's that word patiently, for the coming of the Lord. Through trouble and trial, it stifles complaining. Yeah, we're going to go to Hebrews 11:1, because that's going to define what faith is. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Let me tell you, this was a faith trip for me. It really was, because I couldn't see the end to any of this. I mean, it just looked horrible. But my faith in God and me trusting God and believing that God was going to come through and let the truth come out, that he was going to come through. I just had to keep my heart right. And trust me, the devil put me through a bunch of stuff to try to get my heart out of whack, but it didn't work. I have learned through all this and other things, it's an instant reaction anymore. If somebody says something or offends me or something, that I forgive by faith. It's an automatic response now. I don't have to think about it. It just comes automatic. I mean, you learn through the things that we go through. I mean, we learn through trials. We learn through tribulations. That we get stronger each time we go through something and God brings us out of it. And like the pastor said this morning, we'll be able to help somebody that's going through the same thing that God delivered us out of, and they can see the outcome in us, and we can be an encouragement to them.
That's true.
Yeah. And I got a couple scriptures on trust, and we're going to go to Proverbs 3:5. I think everybody knows this one. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your path. And my other trust scripture is Psalm 37, 3 through 7.
What was it, Kev?
Psalm 37, 3 through 7. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently. There it is again. For him, do not fret because of him who prospers in his ways. And this book here is Desperate Prayers for Desperate Times, and in the first chapter, it's in Hannah in the Bible is the center of this. And if everybody knows, it's 1 Samuel 1. Hannah was barren. She could not have no children. And her husband had another wife, let's see if I can pronounce it, Penina. And she had children. And the devil used Penina to torment Hannah all the time. She would go to the temple every year, they all did, to take their sacrifices there and worship God. And Hannah would always, you know, petition God that she wanted a child. And she even made a vow to God. There's that vow word. She made a vow to God that if God would remember her and bless her with a son, that she would give him back to the Lord for his service, and a razor would never come to his hair. And back then, that would be like a Nazarite vow. They didn't drink, they couldn't have no kind of wine or strong drink, and they didn't shave or cut their hair. And that's how, I mean, they were consecrated to God that way. That was just the thing that they had going on back there. And she promised God that that's what she would do if he would bless her with a son. I'm going to read Psalm 34, 15-19. Says, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. They cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the contrite of spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. We all go through hard times, some more desperate than others. Sometimes we look over into other people's lives and it seems like things are going well, but even they have trouble. None of us is exempt. As the Bible says, he sends rain on the just and the unjust. That's Matthew 5:45. And what we suffer is common among all people. 1 Corinthians 10:13. But as a believer, you have a special advantage. Because of Jesus, you can boldly approach the throne of God and find help in your time of need. You do not have to wait for permission. You do not have to wait for someone else to pray for you. You can go before God and petition for his grace, favor, comfort, strategy, help, wisdom, encouragement, and answers for yourself. And what I've come to tell you is that when you pray, he hears you, he will come and answer and deliver you from all your troubles.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
What's the hope? There's a lot of us praying about all kinds of stuff. These are desperate times that we're living in. And everybody has something going on in their life. I don't care who you are.
Amen.
We all have desperate something.
Amen.
If we don't, then I don't think you're going right for God or something, because the devil leaves you alone, like the pastor said this morning.
Yes.
But what's the holdup on these prayers? If we realize that God knows our needs before we even pray about them, and that if he hears our prayers, we have what? Ask, what could be the holdup in this particular area you've been praying about for so long? Where is the breakthrough? Where is the manifestation? Where is the increase? Where is the fruit? Where is the healing? Most of the delay in prayer has to do with demonic forces, of course. Then there are other circumstances when we have made bad decisions and have to deal with the consequences. And in still other cases, God is delaying our breakthrough in order to bring us to a place where we can handle the thing he is trying to bring about in our lives. He's got to prepare us. There's different reasons why things aren't answered right away. Sometimes we pray for stuff that it's not his will for us. To bring revelation to what God may be doing in your life, we are going to look at the life of Hannah. In her time of desperation, anguish, and torment, and praying for a son, God was leading her to make a vow. The blessing of desperation. Believe it or not, there are blessings that come in seasons of desperation. Without these seasons, we would not be able to build the spiritual strength and character we need to withstand the weight of God's glory. If you are desperate for God to answer a long overdue prayer, if you feel that he has forgotten you, and if it seems your destiny, dreams, purpose, and vision are held up or will not manifest, I want to encourage you not to give in to the voice of the enemy. God does hear your prayers. He will answer. He will help you. He will deliver you and bring his plans to pass in your life. Keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. It is often at our lowest point that you are closest to the greatest miracle.
Amen.
A lot of times we give up right at the time that God is going to do something or answer our prayer or bless us somehow. Because the devil will weigh us down and the battle will be long and you just want to quit. And that's when we got to have each other, to be lifting each other up, encouraging each other, so that we don't give up. Just keep on pressing on.
That's what Pastor Roger was talking about.
too, that the enemy likes to isolate us. This morning he was talking about the enemy likes to isolate us so that we don't have that extra help in prayer or support when you're going through something and you just have all you can take. If you're ready to give up, and Satan isolates you so that you can't help, or you don't have someone to reach out to and someone to support you.
Because the mind is the devil's playground. Amen. He isolates us. He can get in there and do a number on him if you let him. I'm going to give you 5 prayer strategies for desperate times. Number 1 is get even more desperate. Don't hide your feelings from God. Get to the house of God, the house of worship, and pour your heart out to Him. 2 is persevere. Don't give up or give in to the taunts and torment of the enemy. Keep pressing and praying. Your prayers will reach a tipping point in heaven, and angels will be released to act in the heavenlies on your behalf, or whoever you're praying for, or whatever you're praying for. 3, seek God's presence. As you seek God, He will reveal to you the truth of His word. He will give you direction about the things that need to be purged from your life so you can be restored and revived. Sometimes our prayers aren't being answered because we got something in our life that He is trying to purge out of us.
Amen.
So that there's no sin in there. Especially if He's trying to take you to another level, He needs that out of there so the devil can't come back and start tormenting. Hey, you got this in your life, you know? No, that's what He'll do. 4, make a vow to God and keep it. All that God does for His people is based on covenant. The faithful ones receive the blessing of His covenant instead of the curses. Recommitting yourself to God is a way to have the blessings of heaven poured out over your life. 5, prophesy. How many know that we should be prophesying over ourselves?
Amen. And over your children.
And over our children, over our loved ones. We're supposed to be prophesying what we believe in God.
Yes.
Because faith comes by hearing. And hearing is what's, that's going to move God. We just got to prophesy. It says, as you come out of the wilderness, and as God brings deliverance and answers to your prayers, you'll be filled with joy and gladness. Your faith will grow to new levels, and you will begin to believe God beyond what He has done for you. You will begin to see visions of God's favor, mercy, and most of all, His glory reaching out to the ends of the earth. You will begin to believe that the desperate times we are facing as a planet will be eradicated.
That's so good.
Desperate prayers give you the last word over the enemy. When all options are exhausted and everything you were holding onto has failed, God steps in. He hears your cries. He has not forgotten His promise to you. He never turns away the desperate. Your days of weeping are over. No matter where you are in life, how bad things may look, or what situation you find yourself in, I'm here to let you know that you will prophesy again. You will have the last word over the enemy. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He didn't give us the stories in the Bible to put us to sleep at night. He gave them to us to build our faith in the impossible so that we can declare, if He did it for Hannah, Josiah, David, the people of Israel, and the blind beggar on the roadside, He will do it for you.
Amen.
He'll do it for us. I'm going to read 1 Samuel 1, 9 through 11. This is the main focus for this chapter of this book concerning Hannah. So Hannah arose after they had eaten in Shiloh and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest was sitting on a seat by the door of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was bitter and prayed to the Lord and wept severely. So she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give to your maidservant a baby boy, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. Hannah is one of the most recognizable women in the Bible. She's remembered as an amazing woman and the mother of one of Israel's greatest prophets. God didn't only just give her a son. He gave her a great prophet for a son. He really blessed her. But before she was recognized in history as such, her situation looked bleak. In the Hebrew culture at that time, as well as in many cultures today, it was believed that a woman was blessed if she had a large number of children. If she was infertile or barren, it was a sign that she was not blessed. Hannah's husband, Elkanah, had two wives. His other wife, Peninnah, had children while Hannah did not. In her community, Hannah was considered a failure, forgotten, or cursed by God, because that's just how it was back then. And to make matters worse, Peninnah tormented and mocked Hannah because Hannah had no children. Her adversary was the other wife. Can you imagine that one? I don't know how I would have acted back then.
I know how I would have, but it wouldn't have been
godly. Doing all that mess. When your life doesn't look like your name. In Hebrew, Hannah means grace. How many know everybody's name has a meaning?
Amen.
Yeah, it does. In fact, when I was reading this, I was compelled to look up my son's name. His first name is Robert, and I read that it said bright fame or famous. And I thought, Lord, you named him right, but you got to get him all the way out of that devil's hands so he's more famous for you and not for what the devil's going. But I was reading on him, and it was like, that was how my son is. He was. I then understood how come he liked the limelight and I didn't. Yeah. Hannah means grace and is derived from another Hebrew word. I'm not sure how to pronounce this. Canaan, I think. It's C-H-A-N-A-N. Which means favor or favored. In both Hebrew and Greek words translated grace are connected to God's acceptance, loving kindness, goodwill, and mercy given to us. They are also used in connection with the special abilities believers receive from the Holy Spirit that enables us to help draw people into the kingdom of God. We call them gifts of the Spirit. See 1 Corinthians 12. The Greek word for gifts in this context is charisma, which means divine grace. Grace is closely connected to favor. Favor is defined as approval, support, or liking for someone or something, an act of kindness beyond what is due or usual. To feel or show approval or preference for, often used in polite requests. Give someone something desired. It means to give special regard to, treat with goodwill, to show exceptional kindness to someone. Sometimes it means to show extra kindness in comparison to treatment of others. That is preferential treatment. Favor is also friendly regard shown toward another, especially by a superior, gracious kindness, an act of such kindness, aid, assistance. To a Christian, favor with God is what he bestows upon you or gives you. When someone uses their power, influence, position, wealth, authority, or words to help and bless you, That is favor. And it doesn't depend on anything you've done. Favor is unmerited, meaning you don't deserve it. But it is given to you anyway. God is a God of favor. He loves to bless his people simply because he is a good father. And be careful not to be a panina. Sometimes we are the paninas in other people's lives. We hope and pray with Hannah-like desires, but don't realize that bitterness has set in due to our deferred hope. Or we have already received our miracle, but forgotten what the waiting time is like. You know, we've got to, you know, allow for other people. Everybody's going through something. Everybody's going through different things.
Amen.
There's nobody, I don't think, really going through the same things in their lives, because we're all different.
Amen. At different levels, too.
Possibly. Yes. Whatever your position, be careful not to mock and don't despise people who are going through trials. You may end up looking up to them when God takes them from the low place to the high place. Be careful who you laugh at. Sometimes pride causes those of us who are doing well to laugh at those who are not doing well. Sometimes those of us who are blessed will point the finger at others who don't seem to be blessed, saying, they're nobodies. But God is the one who weighs the actions and the hearts of people. And it's the time to reclaim your name. I encourage everybody to Google what your spiritual meaning of your name is. You'll be amazed. You really will. There is a point in the process when you can get worn down from standing in faith against the attacks of the enemy. The Bible says that Hannah was in bitterness of soul, 1 Samuel 1:10, from constantly hearing accusations of failure. This means that she was in deep depression. She was brokenhearted. She had a heart full of grief. She was sad and deeply distressed, and she couldn't shake those feelings. Have you ever had people tell you just to shake it or just try to shake it off, but you can't? Maybe they say, be strong, don't worry, it's going to be all right, believe God. And maybe you do believe God, but you are still in bitterness of soul over your current state. Of course, it doesn't help that the enemy stays in your face telling that you're a failure and you're barren.
That's right.
And barren just don't even have to mean, you know, with child, you can be barren in a lot of different things. And let's not forget that you are aware of whom you have been called to be in the midst of the hardship. Your name is favor, but in this season, your life isn't lining up with that name. Now I'm going to give you five specific actions Hannah took to reclaim the promise of her name. One, don't give up. Year after year, Hannah was tormented and provoked, even though she petitioned God and gave sacrifices yearly. When you're weighed down by the onslaught of attacks from the enemy, combined with the feeling of not having your prayers answered, and the battle wages long, don't give up. That's what the enemy wants you to do in hopes that you will get tired and quit. He wants us to doubt God, and he wants us to get discouraged about our power and authority we have over him.
Amen.
He wants us to lose sight of the reality that through Jesus Christ, we already have the victory. God allows us to go through certain seasons for a period of time to teach us how to fight and how to battle. If I didn't go through all the stuff that I went through, I wouldn't know how to do spiritual warfare like I do. I really wouldn't. And it's the battles that I go through. She tells me all the time, Kat, I don't know how you do it. I said, it's God. It ain't me. I can't do it in myself. There's no way. Two, fast. 1 Samuel 1, 7-8 says, yearly Hannah went up to the house of the Lord. Peninnah provoked her. So Hannah wept and did not eat. Stubborn demons can only be delivered by prayer and fasting. That's why the disciples, when they came out, they couldn't get rid of, cast out those demons. He asked Jesus, and he says, because those have to be through prayer and fasting.
That's good.
And so there's, you know, lots of stubborn spirits that it has to be fasting. Hannah saw that these demons came to steal the seed of the word of the Lord over her life. As God's word suggests, we should take. We should take those attacks of demonic spirits seriously, just as Hannah did. Because if you don't, they're not going to stop. They're just going to keep on keeping on. Because they're going to destroy us. That's what they're out to do, is destroy us. The devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. He hates God, and he knows the only way he can get to God is through God's people.
Exactly.
Three, worship and weep. 1 Samuel 1, 1, 9 through 10. Worship is the gateway to the glory of God, and there are many forms of worship. Shedding of tears and deep supplication as we come recognizing the greatness of who God is, and he is all-powerful and all-knowing. The definition of supplication, the action of asking or begging for something earnestly and humbly, like he fell to his knees in supplication. That's how we need to get, especially for these desperate prayers. It's only going to get worse out there. It's not going to get better. The devil knows the end of the book. He knows his days are really, really numbered now. Four, pray. And she prayed to the Lord. 1 Samuel 1, verse 10. Philippians 4, 6, verses 6 and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with gratitude, make your request known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will protect your hearts and mind through Jesus Christ. And five, make a vow of surrender. Sometimes, oh wait, I'm jumping the gun now. I gotta catch up in my book. When it looks like everything is falling apart and you have no strength, joy, or power, that's when God says, now I can step in with my strength and power. It says, when we are weak, he is strong. Now I can do for you what you cannot do for yourself. And that's where God had to bring my son to. That place right there. He couldn't do it on his own. He had no choice to look up. Unless he was all right with doing all them years, and he wasn't. But that's where God had to bring him to, for him to be able to get to that place. Our God is a God of miracles. Our God is a God of breakthrough. Our God is a God who will not despise your condition if you cry out to him and surrender. Sometimes one of the most powerful things you can do is make a vow to God and keep it. God, if you do this for me, I will serve you. I'll worship you all the days of my life. And don't ever make a vow and forget to keep it. Keep your promise when God grants your request.
Amen.
And God doesn't like ugly. Look at 1 Samuel 2, verse 2. It starts with, there is none holy as the Lord. This verse points out one of my favorite things about God. He is righteous. His righteousness won't allow people to be mistreated without consequences. When God sees people who have been beaten up, beaten down, and tormented, he takes it personally. He says, I'll be your defender. I'll be your savior. I'll be your deliverer. I'll step in when you can't fight your own battle. I'll say the battle is not yours. The battle is not yours. It belongs to me. I'll step in and deal with your situation just to shut up the enemy. God likes shutting up the devil because he is holy and righteous. He hates evil, wickedness, sin, and pride. You know, and all this is done through communication, reading the word, and communicating through prayer to our God. I mean, that's how we have to communicate with him. And if we do all these steps, I'm telling you, it worked for my son. He did this. He's a living testimony that God really moved in his behalf when he did this.
Amen.
All he did was read the first chapter of this book, and he got that part. He really got it.
Where did you get that book, Kat?
I got Ollie's. Do you know what Ollie's is? It's like a discount department store over in Killeen, over there in the shopping center where the old Target used to be. I'm trying to think what's in it.
What's the name of that book?
Desperate Prayers for Desperate Times. You can, I ordered some more of them. I'll go to, I put the title in there and I put used books. And I order a lot of my books from Abe's, A-B-E-S, and they're used, but they're like in mint condition for just a fraction of the price. I think this book I paid $3.99 for. I mean, this is a good book for $3.99. Especially when it teaches you how to pray and what you got to do to get God to move in your situation and to answer.
Chapter. It gets better.
It does get better.
Things get better.
It does better. Get better. This is just the first chapter.
And when you read the book, you feel different. You feel changed. You feel like you've raised a level in God because it teaches you how to grow in God.
My confidence in God, my prayer life in God went up when reading this book. That's
that?
How I'm I'm going through it for the third time.
Who's the author of that book? I tried to order it.
John, I'll spell the letters, Eckhart, it's E-C-K-H-A-R-D-T. He's a good author. He really is.
Would you like one? Would you like a book?
I would love it.
Okay.
I would love it.
God will take you from a place where you aren't able to say anything. He will put his word in your mouth, and the word you prophesy will come forth to generation after generation. I'm here to encourage you that despite what you are going through that is causing you to feel low in silence, God will deliver you, and you will prophesy again. Do you believe it?
Amen.
If you believe it, say this out loud. My Samuel is coming forth.
My Samuel is coming forth.
Amen.
Amen.
And at the end of this chapter, each one of these chapters, he gives prayers to release the blessing of Hannah. And we're not going to do all of them, but I've marked some short ones. So I'm going to Sam, have you repeat them after? We're going to declare this in our lives, in our prayer lives. Okay, let's start. I declare that my name is favor.
My name is favor.
My name is grace.
My name is grace.
God is exalting me.
God is exalting me.
Over the enemy.
Over the enemy.
The enemy will no longer.
The enemy will no longer.
Laugh at me.
Laugh at me.
And mock at me.
And mock at me.
God will not let me.
God will not let me.
Be put to shame.
Be put to shame.
The same miracle that Hannah.
The same miracle that Hannah.
Received will come forth.
Received will come forth.
And to me now.
To me now.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I declare.
I declare.
That I will have.
That I will have.
A Hannah-like breakthrough.
A Hannah-like breakthrough.
And I will prophesy again.
And I will prophesy again.
Lord.
Lord.
I believe the word you have spoken to me.
I believe the word you have spoken to me.
I will not live in a low place.
I will not live in a low place.
I will live in a blessed place.
I will live in a blessed place.
I am not cursed.
I am not cursed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
What the enemy meant for evil.
What the enemy meant for evil.
You're turning around for my good.
You're turning around for my good.
I believe.
I believe.
That you are holy. Lord, that you are holy.
Lord, that you are holy.
You are righteous.
You are righteous.
You see my situation.
You see my situation.
I trust in you.
I trust in you.
You are my strength.
You are my strength.
You are my victory.
You are my victory.
You are my breakthrough.
You are my breakthrough.
I declare.
I declare.
That everything I am.
That everything I am.
Meant to birth.
Meant to birth.
Will come forth.
Will come forth.
Into its prophetic destiny.
Into its prophetic destiny.
Let my prayers.
Let my prayers.
Birth the seed.
Birth the seed.
That will be extraordinary.
That will be extraordinary.
Unusual.
Unusual.
Different.
Different.
Holy.
Holy.
And prophetic.
And prophetic.
I release my faith.
I release my faith.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am prosperous.
I am prosperous.
God will do great things in my life.
God will do great things in my life.
My name is favor.
My name is favor.
The favor of God is on my life.
The favor of God is on my life.
I will walk in favor.
I will walk in favor.
And the grace of God in the days to come.
And the grace of God in the days to come.
Last one. I believe.
I believe.
That fruitfulness.
That fruitfulness.
Returns to my life.
Returns to my life.
Today in Jesus' name.
Today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
I hope you got something out of this.
Oh, yes.
I know. I couldn't believe my son grasped a hold of this and God did for him. I mean, I prayed and everybody else's prayers too, and I know the church was praying too. And he's not out of the woods, you know. He's in there still. I mean, he's confined and he's going to have to bring God out with him. And keep him in his heart and live up to that vow that he made God, or he's going to be in trouble, let me tell you.
The cat, no telling how many lives he's going to bring to Christ through that book right there.
I know. And he told me, yes. I asked him, I said, when you go to TDC, are you going to be able to take it? Because I have this sent in to him and Joyce Meyer's In Search of Wisdom, the other one that I teach out for Proverbs. And he said, no, he has to leave it there. The only thing he can bring is the Bible. I tell you, this is the Joseph anointing on him. All books have to be mailed into a bookstore. It can't even be Amazon anymore.
That's right. Yep.
They let me bring my personal Bible into him, and they gave it to him.
Awesome.
That was God's favor right there.
But he's going to get to take it with him, too.
He gets to take the Bible with him.
Yes.
So I told him, I said, his name are on the books, and he's going to leave them there at the jail and give them to somebody that's going to read them. You know, I have people that I'm helping, because I don't even know these people, but he'll tell me to download their name and stuff, and I minister to them through text.
Yes.
And my son, he's kind of closed up. He's getting better about it. He's more open about talking about God to me. But I hear it from other people that he has talked to.
But by him leaving that book there.
Oh, yeah.
Other people read it. That's what I'm saying. No telling how many people is going to be brought to God through that book.
Amen.
And it started with Bobby being there to begin with.
Amen. Amen. It really is.
We speak that out.
Yes. Yes.
Well, it really is. But I told him, I said, I'll send you two more books. He goes, Mom, he goes, don't send them until they get these in my unit. I said, I won't. Because he knows I'll jump on it to get the word to him.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, yeah.